These mosquito larvae in a lab at Imperial College in London have been genetically engineered to glow red under a laser. But that red fluorescence is just a marker. It's there to tell the researchers that something profound has happened.
I ran out and I grabbed my supervisor and I was like, Tony, you've got to look at this. So we started going through and I read them off one by one. I was like, red, 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 red. And we just, it was a very crazy time. We just started screaming and getting super excited.
Since only one of their parents had a copy of the red gene, you'd expect around 50% of the larvae to be red, but nearly 100% of them were glowing. The researchers had hacked the rules of inheritance with what's called a gene drive. But the red gene isn't the point. It's been linked to a genetic tool that renders female mosquitoes infertile. And that's a huge deal because this isn't just any old mosquito species. This is Anopheles gambi, one of the mosquitoes that carries the parasite that causes malaria.
So malaria is mostly a sub-Saharan African disease. It infects people in the Indian subcontinent, Southeast Asia, but it's primarily a disease of sub-Saharan Africa, and the majority of malaria deaths in any given year in the world, hundreds of thousands of deaths, are kids under 5 in Africa.
Over the past 15 years, there's been a big investment in bed nets, insecticides, and better treatment.
I think the result has been a lot of steady progress on malaria. That being said, it's progress against a really, really high death rate.
Most African countries really want to try and eliminate. And WHO in support of this, they've set themselves some targets to achieve in 2030. And where we stand now, we don't seem to be on course for achieving those.
While researchers continue to work on a vaccine, genetic approaches to malaria look increasingly promising. Genetically modified mosquitoes aren't new. A company called Oxitec has released mosquitoes in Brazil that are designed to have non-viable offspring. But those don't contain a gene drive, which biases inheritance so that the modification continues to be passed through a population, though they can also be designed to have a more local reach. The idea of driving desirable genes into insect populations dates back decades, but progress toward that goal jumped ahead after the invention of the CRISPR gene editing tool in 2012. CRISPR allows scientists to make precise changes to DNA in the lab. A CRISPR gene drive could let them push those changes through a wild population of insects. It works by inserting the gene editing tool itself into a chosen segment of the mosquito's DNA. From there, CRISPR induces the cell to copy the package onto the matching chromosome. Like us, mosquitoes have two copies of each gene, one from each parent. And now that the gene drive is on both chromosomes, it will get passed on to all the offspring, where it will copy onto their other chromosome, and so on. So depending on what biologists attach to that package, like the red fluorescent gene, they can make some drastic changes to wild populations. There are two broad approaches to malaria mosquitoes. The team at Imperial College is part of an international group called Target Malaria, funded mostly by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and they're aiming to use gene drives to suppress mosquito populations. Their drives are designed to spread female infertility or to prevent females from being born, with the effect of shrinking a population of mosquitoes. Then there's a team of researchers at the University of California institutions who have been developing a gene drive that alters rather than shrinks the mosquito population. It spreads genes that make mosquitoes resistant to the malaria parasite, so they don't transmit it between humans. The World Health Organization has outlined the steps that GM mosquitoes should go through before being deployed. Gene drive research is in phase one now, but to find out if it could really work, they need to test it outside of a lab. And the researchers say their mosquitoes should be ready for phase two soon.
I'm hoping the science is well within 5 years, maybe even half that.
Maybe in 1 or 2 years.
A couple of years, but then that's in the lab in London. After something ready in the lab in London, you'd really want to go through very rigorous testing.
So with every health intervention or technology, there's kind of a spectrum of how much testing and how much certainty people require before they just try it.
This is always a trade-off in any medical trial. If you develop a drug and it's like a miracle and it helps everyone, when do you stop the trial and just start giving that to everyone? Once we have a gene drive that we can release in the wild that could wipe out malaria, every year we don't do that is 500 to 700,000, mostly kids, dying. Kevin S. Felt, the MIT scientist who's working on gene drives, was talking to me and he said,
I mean, malaria is a case where there's a strong ethical argument of doing something now today, because so many children have died just in the time that we've been speaking. I would say at least 20.
And his takeaway for that wasn't, let's do this as fast as possible. It's, let's do this right, because if we don't do this right, then there's going to be a massive backlash and we're never going to be able to do anything like this ever again.
Yeah, if you move forwards with a unilateral, we are going to save the kids whether you like it or not, really does imperil the broader malaria eradication effort.
Target Malaria has begun a lengthy process of building facilities and staff in four African countries, where they'll be working with non-gene drive mosquitoes before importing the gene drive mosquitoes. And even then, there's more lab work to do before an actual release.
So the modified one is modified using a laboratory strain. So you have to do experiments to make sure you incorporate the natural genetic background the mosquitoes in the area where you want to work.
At each stage, they're consulting with local communities and with governments about this genetic technology that's designed to spread across borders.
No, there are no regulators that have handled this before, not only just in Africa, but anywhere.
I think I'm curious about, you know, this notion that we have a public conversation, we need to get people on board, this notion that that would somehow lead to some clear consensus or some clear green light. At some point, someone has to decide, and I'm curious if you have a sense of who that is.
Yeah, I mean, I think like that's the million-dollar question, and no one I talked to even pretended to have the answer. The end game that got alluded to by a lot of people was some kind of agreement by the African Union about releasing a self-propagating drive. One tricky thing is malaria does not solely infect people in democratic countries like Ghana or Senegal. It also affects people in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, which despite the name is a dictatorship, countries with really unstable and in many cases really awful governance. So one tricky question is, if the African Union comes together and says, yeah, we're okay with this, is that legitimate? Are they speaking for people in Africa? And I think a lot of the work that scientists are doing is trying to reach out before that and trying to start a conversation before that to make sure it is legitimate.
As the public debate begins, there's a risk that the politics of genetically modified crops could spill over into the mosquito issue. Anti-GMO groups like Friends of the Earth have already called for a moratorium on gene drive research. They fear it will be misused by agribusiness and militaries and cause unintended damage to ecosystems.
We have safe and less risky ways of addressing problems on this planet that aren't about permanently altering nature.
No one in this is as big of a son of a bitch as nature. Like, nature is so awful in every conceivable way. It is completely indifferent to suffering, but I think many of the things we look back on as humans as our greatest achievements, getting rid of smallpox, penicillin, insulin for diabetics, mass vaccinations, those are all things that involved messing with nature and either repurposing or tweaking things that nature created for our own uses. Some of the worst things we've made have also done that. But I look at the Earth as something we gotta keep going for us and for other animals. But I don't look at it as this morally benevolent place. It's a horror show that we're trying to manage as best we can. And this is a ambitious but really interesting way to manage it.
For a bunch more information about this fascinating topic, go read Dylan's feature article on Vox.com. I'll put a link in the comments. And if you're interested in genetic engineering more broadly, we have an episode on our Netflix show called Designer DNA, and it's about genetic engineering in human beings. That's on Netflix. Go check it out. Check out all the other episodes too. We're publishing them weekly on Wednesdays.